APIs and this and that. We have started learning a little bit, but still there are far way to go. The only thing that I can say with confidence about the human brain is it's such a multifaceted organ that you can do anything and everything with it. Take a simple thing which we are so used to. You are, let's say, going in your vehicle, or you have to go in your vehicle. You're talking to a friend who is with you. You put all your mind to the conversation and you're focusing on the topic and you are trying to recall what all to say. At the same time, as soon as you near your vehicle, you put your hand inside your purse or your pocket, pull out the keys. You put the key, you turn it clockwise, or you use that button which opens the car doors automatically. You hear the sound that it is saying that yes, the door is open. You open the door, sit down, start the vehicle, and start moving, all while you are discussing with your friend. Not only that, supposing there is something that you need to think or be aware of. So your action is driving the vehicle. Your words are what you are discussing with your friend. But your thoughts are on, as soon as I get home, I should do this. Or maybe I should stop in between and make a phone call and inform somebody about something. So the brain has got the capacity to use it in diverse ways, including a lot of multitasking. But neurologists, after this recent research and this and that, have been cautioning us that we are not using the brain sufficiently. Rough estimates are that most of us use our brain maybe 10 or 20% of what we are capable of using. And unfortunately, even that 10 or 20% that we are using is only in one direction. A person who is techie thinks only technology, thinks only computers, thinks only software. And without even realizing, his mind also starts thinking that way for non-IT and not work-related things. Somebody else is an accountant or banker. Somebody else is a lawyer. Somebody else is a teacher. Somebody else is an artist. We make that part of our life, at least as far as the brain is concerned. Ask yourself this to start with. Ask yourself a simple question. Your hobbies, particularly the hobbies which you actually practice, are those hobbies away from your regular work? If your work, for example, involves numbers, you're an accountant or a banker or a finance person. So your work involves a lot of what we will call as mathematical, logical, sequential thinking. So at work, you're using that. For your hobbies, are you using something which is complementary to that, like creative, emotional, literary, intuitive? Are you using those type of skills? If you are, then you are probably one of those who is using the brain more than that 10 or 20% which neurologists tell us about. If you're not doing that, if you're stuck to only your work and only your areas of focus, then you are neglecting the rest of the brain. And why is it that children are very creative and adults are not as creative as children? Because we have allowed that skill, that intelligence, the creative intelligence, to slowly wither away by focusing only on what is important to us. The good news is it's never too late. Even today, you can start the process of thinking outside the box. I had put up in the topic a little blurb saying that why is it that a black-colored buffalo eats green-colored grass and produces white-colored milk? Did that thought ever strike to you? I'm just giving that as a very, simplistic example. Anything, you enter into a new premises and you start thinking, why is the length of this hall so much more than the width? Why are the windows placed this way? Why is it that that stage or screen or whatever it is in this direction? When you are moving around on the roads, do you start thinking, what would happen if I take this detour from this side? What is it that will help me if I move out this way? Do you think it will be better that I wear a jacket or a sweater when I leave home and it is very, very cold? Or do I think that that chill will be there only right in the beginning? The day is likely to be very warm. I'm not going to be comfortable wearing the sweater. So it's better to, you know, tolerate for half an hour that morning chill. And then as the sunlight starts coming in, the day is going to be very warm. I'm going to be very uncomfortable wearing this sweater the whole day. See how these things go. And that is what creativity is all about. Somehow we are under this false impression that creativity is to do with art. We think creative people are artists, those who draw, those who paint, those who do sculptures, those who do whatever, you know, we think that they are the creative people. That's not true at all. Creativity encompasses every aspect of your life. Creativity can be used, for example, you're facing a difficult person. There's an issue on which you have to interact with that person, and the person is a little unreasonable person. If you tell directly to this person what you are thinking or what you are wanting, he may get unhappy with you. Things may go bad. So when creative thinking comes in, you say, can I change the way I'm talking to this person? Can I use different type of words or language or whatever it is? Can I build a foundation by first agreeing to something that he likes and then talking about something which he probably does not like? Instead of talking to him face to face, can I first send him a message giving an outline of what I want to discuss? Will that help in cooling him down and, you know, bringing him into the forefront of the issue instead of me meeting him and then straight away start to tell him? Is it better that I meet in his premises, my premises, in a neutral premise? Where would he be in a better position to at least listen to me or agree to what viewpoint I am putting? That is what is creativity. Parents who have difficulty with growing children. I'm doing so much to discipline my child, but somehow the child doesn't seem to be getting disciplined at all. What do you need to do? You need to be creative. You need to start thinking, this is my child. I love my child. I want to give the best to my child. I have tried out a method, not once, but 10 times. In different ways, tried to force, tried to plead, tried to bribe, tried to do something, but I'm not succeeding. I'm not getting the change in behavior that I want my child to show. So instead of chasing on the same line, can I go around? Can I think of some other method to achieve the same goal? That is what is creativity. When I talk to children, you know, particularly those who say, I don't like some subject, or I'm not doing very well, or I'm getting exam stress and all that, I tell them a simple thing. I mentioned it on this platform also earlier. I tell them, have a look at your fingerprint, your thumb. These lines that you see over here, they are unique. Almost 8 billion, 800 crore people in this world, and nobody has a fingerprint like yours. So what does it mean? You are different from others. You are unique. You have certain things which others don't have. And the same applies to the fingerprint of the brain. Call it brain print or whatever you want to call it. Everybody's brain is different. Now, what you nurture is what develops. What you neglect slowly goes down. So if I decide that I'm an engineer or I'm a lawyer or I'm whatever I am, and therefore, what has drawing got to do with my life? Why should I do drawing, painting or anything like that? It's a waste of time. What am I doing? A particular intelligence or a particular skill which I already have in me, I'm allowing it to die out. Same thing with speaking. If I say, no, I'm happy with my two or three friends whom I've had right from my childhood. I'm happy going to office, doing my work, saying hello, hi to everybody. I don't have animosity. I don't get into arguments with anybody, but I don't make friends also. Even in the neighborhood, there are neighbors and this and that. They're nice people. So if I'm passing by, I say hi, good morning, good evening. I don't go to their house and I don't invite them to my house. What am I doing? There's a thing called interpersonal intelligence. I'm losing that. One fine day, when there is a need for me to do something which involves interpersonal skills or interpersonal intelligence, I find it very difficult. And I say, no, I can't make friends. I'm not an expert extrovert. I'm not good at socializing. But it is you who created the situation, remember that. And it is you who can change it. That is what I was telling you. It is never too late. It doesn't matter what your age is. In fact, I spent this morning in a very wonderful program of a special school who's completed 30 years. And I went and sat down next to Mrs. Krishnaswamy, who is the founder of Spastic Society of Karnataka, and probably the mother figure of special education, particularly in Bangalore, even outside. So I was just talking to her, and she immediately came out with, you know, Ali, I'm 91 years of age, so I've slowed down. I can't do things. I said, okay, ma'am, can we do something? You have said 91, no? Can I take that 91 and reverse the order? Can I put the one ahead and the nine behind? She started laughing. How are you going to do that? I said, I'm going to do that by helping you think outside the box. What is so important about being 91? And as long as your cognitive senses and your cognitive abilities are the same. I know of 60-year-old people who start thinking that I've become too old, my memory is going bad, I can't think. And I know 90-year-old people like Mrs. Krishnaswamy who are absolutely alert. Yes, she has trouble walking and this and that, usual old age issues. But how important is that? It is the brain which is important. And we need to continuously keep nurturing it. If you can start thinking in different ways, and that involves a very simple thing called curiosity. If you have that curiosity, you can start becoming creative. Now, the point is, what do you need to be creative? So, Anis has made this quick bullet points for us. What are the basic things that we need to become more creative and to nurture our creative, talents or abilities? The first one is flexibility, adaptability. Being willing to change, being willing to try out different things, being willing to do things in a different way starts with that. Then, as I was just now mentioning, not just curiosity, but intense curiosity, constant curiosity. Why is this person behaving like this? Why is this building made in such and such fashion? Why is it that the traffic is getting more congested in this area and not in that area? If you have that intense curiosity and you keep nurturing it more and more, back it up with positive attitude. You're stuck in a traffic jam? Say, hey, that gives me a chance to listen to some nice music which I have been missing out on. Or this gives me a chance to catch up with my friend. I'll make this phone call and leisurely sit in the vehicle and talk to the person. Because anyway, there's a traffic jam. Nothing I can do about it. This is what I call as positive attitude. The next is to develop strong motivation and determination. Remember, motivations comes from within. Nobody else can motivate you. They can facilitate the process of, increasing your motivity, but You cannot change. You cannot borrow motivation from somebody else. Then you have to be a risk taker and you have to learn from failures. There are two types of people. Those who say, I tried, I put in my best effort, nothing happened, I'm a failure. There's somebody else who says, I failed in achieving certain such thing which I tried by a particular method. Now, let me change the methodology. Let me try out something different, something new. How you can do that is to go into what we call as multiple intelligences or life skills for that matter. Take the 10 life skills which have been enunciated by World Health Organization. Two of them, which complement each other, are critical thinking and creative thinking. You have to balance the two. There are times when it is needed for you to evaluate and think critically. There are times when you need to think creatively. Firstly, to be able to check out which is to be used at what time. That is what helps you to, expand your creative thinking. Just to give you a quick example, I remember my very dear friend, Dr. Gururaj Kharajgi. Sometimes what he does with students is he goes to the blackboard and he calls the students and says, can any one of you come to the blackboard and draw a triangle using two lines? Some of them straight away start laughing. So the definition of a triangle is to have three sides, sir. How can you draw a triangle with two sides? Yes, that is the definition of a triangle. But can you use the side of the blackboard and draw two lines? The side of the blackboard becomes the third side. So with two lines, you made a triangle. Then you can even expand that. Draw on the corner of the blackboard, only one line, diagonal. You have two sides of the blackboard, which form two sides of the triangle, and you use the third. Now, from there, the thinking starts. I'm just giving that as a quick example to show you how, if you have that intention, if you have that, curiosity, if you have that determination and motivation, you can do wonders. And that brings me to the most important point of today's session. How do you actually practice that creativity, nurture that creativity, and build that creativity? Okay. So I shortlisted. There are various areas, obviously, there are so many of them. I've just shortlisted about 10 or 11 of them. And very simple ones. Have a look. Dressing style, for example. Do you have exactly the same dressing style all the time, or do you keep changing the dressing style? Does your dressing style change to adapt to the weather and to the places and stuff like that? Or do you wear, very heavy dress early morning because it is chilly and the whole day now you are sweating away because you're wearing such a heavy dress? So many factors are there. Are you wearing a dress which is acceptable to that particular occasion? You're going for a very formal occasion. You're expected to dress in some way. Or are you overdressed at some times when you're going for a very informal occasion? Then start with what I call as greeting one person. Practice and see. How do you greet people? Do you do it in different ways, different times? The same person. You have a friend or you have a colleague whom you meet every day. Do you practice greeting in different ways? If you do that, you'll see the benefits of it. Then greeting a group. When you are with a number of people, how do you greet them? I know of people who are very scared to, even talk with a group, public speaking as it is called. That is a skill which is inborn in all of us. Any one of us can learn. Greeting a group, talking to a group, convincing a group. Very creative activity which can be developed. Take a simple thing like your sitting posture or standing posture. Do you sit in such a way that you are most comfortable? And similarly, do you sit in such a way which is acceptable to other people? You know how our culture is. If you have elders sitting in front of you and you're sitting relaxed with your legs crossed, they don't like it. So can you keep adapting yourself to that? Even a simple thing like a sitting or a standing posture. Then taking further into interpersonal skills, reaching out, giving a positive stroke. A positive stroke is nothing but, you know, a genuine praise, verbal or non-verbal. How often do you do it? Monitor yourself and see. Giving a suggestion for change. Yes, every time we have a meeting, we have the speaker on the left and the audience on the right. Can we try out by putting the speaker on the right and the audience on the left? Can we just change the position of those chairs and try it out how it looks? You're sitting down for dinner with your family. You say, today, can we try out a different way of eating our food or a different sequence of how you eat? Or maybe we'll play some music in the background while we are sitting and eating. Or do we take up one particular topic and discuss it? Then demonstrating one unique talent of your demonstrating. Please note the word. Not just nurturing the unique talent, but demonstrating. Don't be so modest that you say, yeah, I do some drawing, but I don't show it to anybody. Yeah, I play a musical instrument, but I can't do it in public. Demonstrate. That's where your out-of-box thinking comes out. Observing things that others generally overlook. That's a very, very strong indicator that you are a creative person. Things which people do not see. Are you the person who sees it, notices it, and picks it up? It expands your horizons so much, you know. Then something like telling a unique story or incident. How do you do it? There are people who talk and talk and talk. They'll take up some incident. You know what happened 1 year back or 10 years back? And they keep on repeating the same incident or the same story. There are those who create unique stories, unique incidents, or explain what you learned from that experience or from that incident. Taking others' opinions and matching it with yours. Then observing someone and telling what you think is going on in his mind, using body language, for example. I observe body language and I can at least make a calculated guess what must be going on in his mind. The more I do it, the more creative I am. I won't be successful or correct 100% of the time. It doesn't matter. But as I keep doing this sort of exercise, I will become more and more proficient in understanding people. Then look for somebody who is creative. Okay. Identify one person whom you have identified or you have acknowledged rather as a creative person. Analyze that person. How is he different from me? How is he different from my other friends? We can learn so much by analyzing the creativity of the other person and learning a lesson from it. And doing things differently by ourselves, not just blindly copying. Just because he said something or he did something, yeah, yeah, this looks good. This, I think, makes a person successful. Or with this, I think, you know, we will really be able to do something good. Use that and come out with something. I mean, if you allow me to be immodest, that's what I do when I Google for information. I keep looking up some websites or looking for something. Like today, for example, I have to, you know, give this session on creative thinking. I go to the internet. I do Google and check out what exactly is creative thinking. But I don't write down what is coming on the screen. I think and evaluate my own method of doing the same thing. So when you can learn how to do things differently, there's a proverb, no, that Successful people don't do different things. They do things differently. They are also like you and me. And I would remove successful and make it creative people. That is how it goes. And it is a continuous, you know, exercise. To be able to do that, you also have to accept reality, your limitations. Limitations which are, you know, which you can overcome, and limitations which will remain with you for lifelong. So the moment you identify that I have this particular limitation, instead of feeling bad about it, see how you can convert it into something good. I will never forget that boy. I was talking to 200 children of 10th standard in a particular school once. And I asked, is anybody willing to share how you are unique? You are different from everybody else. One tiny little fellow came onto the stage. I was wondering, he doesn't look like a 10th standard student. What is he doing here? I asked him, what do you want? He said, I want the mic. I thought he brought some message or some instruction from the principal or something like that. He wants to make that announcement. I gave him the mic. He took the mic, looked straight at all his friends and said, among all the people sitting here in this hall, I am the shortest. And not only I am the shortest, nobody in future can become as short as me. See, normally a person who is the shortest in the class would be bullied, would be teased. And you would have low self-esteem. I got to be the shortest. What is wrong with me? How can I increase my height? But here he is using it to an advantage. And this is what you need to think if you genuinely want to become a creative person, to think from the point of view of creativity. I do this simple little exercise which I call creative visualization. Manthan, I always do it and people really enjoy. I get very positive feedback whenever I do this creative visualization, visualizing something in a very creative manner. It is there on on YouTube. If you pick up, one of those YouTube videos where I have done creative visualization, within 5-10 minutes, you will get an idea of what it is. You can bring about changes into that and do it in your own way. That is creativity. So, don't you think I deserve a 1-minute break? Purni is here. She'll tell you some interesting things and I will be back.
Good afternoon. Hot khana has happened, I hope. And you are not dozing off. You are not gone off to sleep. And you have ensured that you keep your time aside for this talk. So what does that tell you? That you are a creative person who wants to understand the different facets of life. So that is what you are. And I'm so happy to be with you as a part in this whole thing. Okay. So I have some little information for you. Good afternoon, Vinita. Ali was telling, you know, a creative person thinks out of the box. And now we had a Manthan camp. That is Banjara's retreat in Bangalore on the airport road. Na? So we had a Manthan camp, and the topic was being happier with yourself. Not happy. Many will say, oh, I'm already happy. So the topic was being happier with yourself. And we had actually a lot of fun. A lot of fun. I don't know how many of in this group had come for this camp. I think it's really a nice thing. For you to attend once in a while. It's so tucked in, but it's so much in the city. And we did so many out of the box, childlike, creative things. And it was really a lot of fun that we all had. So we had a WhatsApp group so that we can coordinate the activities, you know, what time you come, what you do. All those things were coordinated. And even today, it was last Sunday, half day, we all returned back. We went on Friday evening and then whole of Saturday and Sunday after lunch, we all split. So there were a lot of sessions by Ali. Then there was, what do you say, sessions by Ali, and then there was activities. A lot of activities happened. And when all these things happened, there was so much of a closeness that got immediately done on that day that we opened up. We had a WhatsApp group for coordination. And even today, that group is buzzing with different things, you know, that happened at the Manthan camp on that day. And in fact, Surekha is writing something. Yes, Surekha, you were also there, and we still are reminiscing the Manthan camp, which was so wonderful. So if you, you know, want to, if you have a nice group of last week also, I told you, school kids, college kids, your own family people, and some or some kind of a ladies group, young people group, whatever. And if you think that, you know, there can be a topic which can be picked up and a 2 days workshop can be done. Manthan is an excellent place. And we as a Banjara team will take up the whole project on your behalf. It has to be your thought and our actions for you. So that was what I thought I wanted to share with you. And so for those who think, oh, I think, did I miss out on Manthan? We are arranging one more Manthan camp in February. Enough long notice has been given to you. February 17th, that is Friday, Saturday, Sunday, 17, 18, 19. That is the time. You can call up, register right now itself and, you know, book your seats so that you can do. Come down and experience it. And for those, you know, known to you who are out of Bangalore, we have our course, which is called the International Program in Counseling and Guidance. It's an online course. The speciality is that it has an exclusive mentor for the student. So anyone who is desirous of reaching out to the public, reaching out to society at large, do let us, let them know and let us know. We will ensure that whatever that needs to be done, spoken to them, we will do all that. Absolutely, Surekha, it was a mind-blowing thing. Absolutely, and a lot of fun we had. And now, for your creative thinking, whatever questions you have, Ali is over here. He is back and I'm out. So see you soon. Have a nice time.
Let me see how creative your comments and questions are. So we shall start with Kaira Lee, who says, our mentor, guide, teacher, and friend who has dedicated her life for understanding the needs of children. She's referring to whom I referred, that is Mrs. Rukmini Krishnaswamy, a living legend, as I mentioned, 91 years and still going strong. Her cognitive abilities are so sharp that when I just quietly, when she was sitting there, I slid myself next to her. And by the time I could turn, her hand was on my hand. And she said, I've been thinking of you so much. I want to catch up with you. Will you come? I'll call you. That's all. She didn't have to. Normally with an elderly person, what happens? You have to reintroduce. I am Ali. You remember me. Oh, yeah. So this is what, you know, is the thing. And let me tell you, it is people like Mrs. Krishnaswamy who are extremely creative. And that is why they can achieve what they have achieved, and they can reach out to so many people, and they can be so active even in the sunset years of their life. Then Surekha says, creativity is seeing what others see and thinking what no one else ever thought. Yes, starts with seeing something which others are not able to see. It's very funny. We do these exercises also sometimes, you know, with our students. You know, there are those drawings which have a drawing in a drawing. My favorite one is a sketch which in one glance looks like an old lady. But you look at it a little differently, in another perspective, it looks like a young girl. I ask people, what do you think is the age of this person whose sketch has been drawn here? There are people who say maybe 70, 80. At the same time, somebody raises a hand and says, no, no, maybe teenager. I said, what? How can one person be 80 years old and a teenager? Because both are looking at different things. Of course, there are a few who immediately pick up and say, no, no, actually, there are two faces in it. So you look at it this way, it looks like a young girl. If you look at it that way, it looks like an old lady. Those are the creative ones. So starting with something as simple as being able to see what others are not seeing and thinking what no one else thought. People see something and they don't get out of the thing. My favorite joke on this is about Sherlock Holmes. Sherlock Holmes had his, you know, lieutenant, the Dr. Watson, and he used to bounce off all his ideas over him. They did a lot of investigative work, murders, this, that, crime. One day Sherlock told Watson, let's take a break and go out into nature and camp for 2-3 days and come back. Watson was also very happy, both of them. Packed a tent and all the supplies and this and that and went into the jungle and open area, located a very nice, beautiful spot with a river close by. They did some fishing. They lit a fire. They cooked that fish and they ate. Then they set up the whole tent nicely. And after a lot of evening spending, talking and reminiscing, they went inside the tent and they fell asleep. Middle of the night, Sherlock Holmes wakes up Dr. Watson and says, Watson, look up at the sky and see what do you see. Watson looks up and says, I see innumerable stars. Yeah, but what do you actually see? He says, I see that great bear, that small bear. I even see that, North Star. I see so many of these things. That's it. Nothing else. No, no, I also see in the extreme towards the west, you know, there's a reddish glow. Normally, it is predicted that when there's a reddish glow in the west, then there's possibly going to be rainfall or something like that. Acha, what else do you see? He says, I see some vague cloud formations and this and that among the stars. Okay, yeah, what else do you see? Come on, I have told everything that I see. And Sherlock Holmes tells him, Watson, you fool, somebody has stolen our tent. When you're sleeping inside the tent, how do you see the stars and the sky? He didn't give a thought to it. This may be a joke, but this lays the point that you have to have thinking, seeing, and describing beyond what others are used to be seeing, right? Yes, Surekha also, Surekha's Purnima has already gone away, Surekha. I'll convey to her. It was mind-blowing in terms of personal growth and unadulterated joy, right? Purnima's? Seen that, okay. Purnima's already seen it, yeah. Surekha says, crafting win-win outcomes could be one of the finest manifestations of creative thinking. Yes. See, any skill like creative thinking or anything else can be used for good purposes and can be used for bad purposes, right? Here, you have to understand that if you have a positive attitude, if you like to take people together, if you are the type of person who wants to balance your life with others, then you can use creative thinking to create what we call as win-win outcomes. What is this win-win outcomes? It is, you also win, I also win. I don't like to win at your cost. I don't want to put you down. and I will not allow you to win at my cost. So let's do some creative thinking, out-of-box thinking. Let's explore options in such a way that we have win-win outcomes. Sridevi says, is it balancing the creative and rational mind that brings out one's unique personality? Yes, Sridevi. A lot has been said about balancing the creative and the critical or rational, as you said. So we have this left brain and we have the right brain. The left brain generally thinks sequentially, analytically, creatively, rationally. The right brain thinks creatively, spatial, emotional, intuitive. An ideal person is one who can balance the two, who can nurture both sides of the brain. That's what I was saying, that use more and more of the brain which you normally don't use in your day-to-day activities. And you are expanding your thinking, you are expanding your abilities, your capabilities, etc. Yes, Madhavi says, I put my creativity in my paintings. I cheer up myself, feel better when I feel low. See, anything that comes from within, you know, like paintings. And if it is something which you do from your ideas, some people do very good painting, but they copy. They keep a nice painting or photo or something in front of them and they work on it. That is what we call as spatial intelligence. They're very good at, you know, reproducing the same thing which is there in that photograph or the painting. But a creative person is one who visualizes and then draws or paints. What you are painting is not visible right in front of you. It is a part of your imagination or maybe even part of old memories. I remember I had gone on vacation to such and such very exotic spot, and it's still embedded in my mind so many years later. So now I will paint it. That is what enhances your creative thinking and your creative abilities. Surekha is asking a very relevant question. How can we discipline a wild mind to think creatively? You know something? Wild minds are already creative. It is the minds which follow that is a straight path which are not creative. They think this is the only way to do it and this is the only way. And unfortunately, our education system promotes that. No. Children give innumerable tests and exams, which are what we call as MCQ, multiple choice questions. So the question is asked and you are given five options, A, B, C, D, E, and you have to select one of them. Like how you did in Kaun Banega Crorepati also. Now, the thing is, in real life, there is no specific answer. It is not that B is right or D is right. B may be right 40%, D may be right 30%, E may be right 20%. So you have to start thinking in that particular way. So in order to answer Surekha's question, if you have a wild mind, which is restless, which keeps jumping from one place to another, do not discipline the wild mind. Channel it. If, you know, you must have seen in those good old Western movies, there's this horse which is just not being tamed. And somebody is hitting, somebody is holding, somebody is pulling it down. It doesn't work. So what does the hero do when he comes? He jumps onto the horse and allows it to run. And he is hanging onto it. So what is he doing? He's actually encouraging that restlessness, that wild attitude of the horse. And at one point, the horse slows down. And then the horse becomes tame. And then the horse is managed very well by the rider. The same thing applies to your mind. Madhavi also says that creativity, they published distinct imagination. Yes, it is a fact. You can look at it in so many different ways, but you have to be open to it. And people who become unnecessarily critical, people who become, I would say, judgmental. People who always question and reject. Why is he behaving this way? Why is he not doing this? Why is this person talking like that? I don't know what their impact on the other person is, but they are definitely creating, killing their creativity. So don't ever do that thing of, you know, always questioning, putting down, no, this is stupid. Why is that person doing this? That should not be done. I don't like this type of behavior. You have a right to your attitude, your likes and dislikes. But constantly going on and on and on, talking about those things becomes counterproductive and it reduces your creativity. This, I think, is a very good question. Maybe we can wind up with this. Surika says, is creativity a skill which can be practiced and nurtured? Yes, straight away I can tell you yes. Like we talk about multiple intelligences or we talk about life skills, creativity is one of them. Creative thinking, rather, is one of them, or creative intelligence, whatever name you want to give it. It can definitely be identified and then found out which is the right way of developing it, and then practicing it, and then nurturing it. That is the only way by which you can ensure that on a long-term basis you will. And there's something really interesting. You develop creative thinking in one aspect of your life, it overflows into other areas. You start doing some creative activity in your free time, in your office also, you start developing a creative thinking to the work that you are doing. Just to give you an example, there was this wonderful person called Trevor Ellis who came all the way from USA. He was looking for the ideal school for his children. He went and saw so many schools and he narrowed down to Montessori. He said, Montessori is the best method for my children. He has three children. One by one, all three of them he put into Montessori school. But you know something, he runs a flying training school. He's a flight instructor. He started asking himself, why should Montessori techniques be restricted only to small children? My trainees who are training to become pilots are also like children. They are also my students. Why can't I start using that method? He did it. He is still doing it. And not only is he successful, his trainee is the pilot. They appreciate him. They say that, you know, training under Mr. Trevor is far better than training under any other instructor because we get the opportunity to grow and blossom out. Roshan says, creative people are highly successful in their endeavors. Yes, most of the time. Let me also caution you that sometimes you may be very creative, but you may not be successful. That does not mean creativity is bad. That does not mean your thinking was wrong. That does not mean your method was wrong. It could be circumstances are wrong. I work in an organization, let us say, where the bosses or the management don't want to do things differently. They want everything to be done exactly as they have been doing for the last 30 years. Now, I bring in creative thinking. What happens? I don't succeed. I run up the wrong side. They become critical about me. They scold me. Nothing comes out of it. So I just wanted to tell you that while Roshan is right in saying creative people are mostly successful in their endeavors, sometimes you try something creative, you are not successful, it still does not mean that creativity is bad. It's just circumstances were bad, responses were bad, time was bad, and that is how you start thinking in a different way. Yes, Vinita says, actually creativity can be applied everywhere in whatever you do. I do try to apply it, whether it's cooking, gardening, or counseling. Wonderful example. Thanks a lot, Vinita. You have given it in a very concise form that creativity can be in such a wide range be it cooking, be it gardening, be it counseling. These are three completely isolated and different activities and skills, isn't it? But like Trevor Esser did by importing Montessori methods into flying training, this is what Vinita is also telling us, that she does it in cooking, in gardening, and in counseling. You do it in whatever you are doing. Learn to be creative in the way you drive your vehicle. Learn to be creative in the way you deal with your family members. Learn to be creative in, thinking of some activities which you have never done before and which you would like to do now and see what the outcome is going to be. At the same time, being prepared for failures, because failures are the stepping stones to success. And creative people inevitably think that way about failures also. That's also a creative trait. To be able to say, I tried something with good intention, I put in effort, but I did not succeed. So what has happened? I have learned a lesson. I know that now I have to think differently. I have to do it in different ways, or I have to try out some different activities to do. I can do that very well. Yes, Jyoti says, I have noticed creative people get affected quickly. Yes, generally creative people are also, since they are right-brained people, they are also, a little more emotional, a little more intuitive, a little more sentimental and sensitive. That is why it does happen that creative people do get affected, but that should not be a hindrance. That should not be. Sometimes it's good to get affected, because when you get affected, you think. And you start bringing in a change, or you try to do something differently. If you are that hard nut who doesn't get affected by anything, you may be doing something in a wrong way, you won't even realize, and you'll continue doing it, and you will either be a failure in long term, or you'll spoil your relationships. So give a thought to it. It's a continuous process. Start listing down the type of creative things that you can do from now on. Start building up on them and how you can do it. And of course, we shall be meeting next, Saturday, same time at 2 o'clock. And the topic is going to be how to learn from your role models. There are so many wonderful role models who can inspire and motivate us. Here again, I think it's an extension of creative thinking that I'm not going to restrict myself only to my parent, my teacher, my boss, my somebody. You don't know where you can learn from. And these people who teach you something without actually teaching you are role models. So we are going to have this. In fact, I've already started surveying a lot of people, asking them who are your role models and why. I'm going to present you with some of those videos, which we are recording of people who are giving us different viewpoints and stuff like that. And Jyoti said, very creative session. Thanks, Ali. Thanks to Jyoti. Thanks to all of you for being part of this continuous movement. Let's enjoy ourselves. See you next Saturday. Bye-bye.